Good evening, Sonder fam. You are joining us on a marvelous Monday. I'm your facilitator tonight, Jennifer Ogilvy. I am coming to you from the Dallas, Texas area, a community called Garland, and it is the perfect Chamber of Commerce weather day here. We have our windows open. There's a beautiful breeze blowing. The sun is shining. The temperature's perfect. And I always laugh. I say April is actually code word for it's almost time to start complaining about the Texas heat. So we soak in these days when we can get them before we start getting a little too warm. On the other end, you're jealous. Well, I do feel like it's way better than snow. I'm a wimp. I don't think I would last in a snowy environment. Joining us on the other end of our team tonight is a fabulous facilitator. I know if you've been around before, you know our Bailey, our sweet Bailey, and she is going to be manning our chat tonight. So if questions come up about Silk and Sonder in general, or you just want to know a little more information, she's your girl. She can throw some links in. She's going to be able to provide some of the information I'll be sharing just about Silk and Sonder at the end, links, how to watch this again if you want to. She's going to have a link for that, all that good stuff. So if anything pops up, let Bailey know. And if she doesn't know, she'll drop in the link to contact the headquarters of Silk and Sonder. But I'm so glad to have her on the other end tonight. And we are both very excited about spending this time with you, working on your Radiance Labyrinth. You have found yourself at an exclusive event. This is not in your journal. And so you just be very proud of yourself for, you know, signing up to do our exclusive events tonight. I'm really, really glad that you are here with us. So let's get going, right? I did put a little blurb on the front, and somebody said that they even have chills thinking about it. World Labyrinth Day is coming up. It is always the first Saturday of every May. And so you might want to make a little note in your phone that is coming up, and you can sit with, be very intentional on that Saturday and sit with the labyrinth that you are getting ready to create. It's a wonderful meditation tool. If you've ever had an opportunity to walk a labyrinth, you know what a meaningful experience it can be. And if you haven't, maybe after this, you'll be, I saw somebody say, I'm Googling, like, where can I find a labyrinth? So there are labyrinths located all over our communities. Sometimes they may be affiliated with a space of worship. They may be found in public parks. A lot of hospitals will have them on their grounds if they have that kind of space. So they are located everywhere. And again, I mentioned they are wonderful meditation tools. So we're going to make a smaller version that you can pull out at any time. A labyrinth is really cool because it's kind of like the path of life. There's lots of twists and turns along the way, but it definitely, you know, we find our center in it as we journey in and out of the labyrinth. And anyway, I'm just super glad that we are gathered here today. Now, we are virtual, of course, so hopefully we won't have any little weird things go on with the internet. But, you know, should we crash and burn for whatever reason, just know I'm going to do my best to get back on. But I like to kind of remind everybody something could happen, but we're going to cross our fingers that it doesn't. A recording of this social is going to be available within a day or two. And Bailey will share those links at the end of our time together. And otherwise, let's make sure you've got a pencil and an eraser. That's really important for the first part of our social. And then markers, crayons, any kind of tools that you like to use, washi tape, if you have that available. It's not necessary, but we are going to kind of personalize our labyrinths and make them ours. And hopefully you were able to see some labyrinths in Sonder Club earlier. So this month's theme is radiance. And the beautiful thing about our socials is that we gather together and we always dig into our theme. And so we're going to do an activity around radiance. It's kind of going to get our minds ready for working on our labyrinth. We'll start with that. Then we're going to work on our labyrinth. And within the time of working on our labyrinth, toward the end, I'm going to walk you through the steps that you will need, that you need to know about to be able to utilize the labyrinth as a meditation tool. So we'll build it, but then I'm going to show you how to actually use it. All righty. And then we'll close up and I'll have my song list at the end. If you wanted to snap, if you like the tunes that I've chosen and you'd like to recreate them in your own list, you can. So let's get started with our activity, shall we? If you can find space in your journal, it can be a small space. It doesn't have to be a whole notes page. We will need a whole notes page for the labyrinth, but this could just be a small space. Maybe your scratch pad, or maybe you have some space somewhere in your weekly spread. And I want to share with you one of my favorite pictures of all times. This is sunset at Lake Buchanan in Burnet, Texas. And I've done this social one other time and somebody went, Burnet, Texas. That's one of those funny Texas pronunciations. We always like to say it's Burnet, darn it, learn it. So Burnet, Texas. And this was taken on Christmas of 2020. So it was at the end of the day. And yeah, like Pflugerville, Jessica, that's a crazy one. Yes, y'all are putting all the funny Texas towns up. So we had this beautiful Christmas time with our family, beautiful Christmas day, and the sun went down. And this is a straight out of the phone shot. And it was one of the most radiant sights my eyes had ever seen in my life. I just couldn't get over how the sky was lit up. And I wanted to talk a little bit about sunsetting, because in business, the word sunsetting is actually the strategic and intentional phasing out or retiring of something. And I underline the words intentional and strategic. Right? It's not just something happens. It's not things that we should be doing. There's a strategy and an intention behind sunsetting. And companies may put to bed a product or a service or a brand or hardware or software. And products and services are sunset when they are no longer profitable. And I added the word beneficial. Or when a company just decides to change strategy or focus. And so with that in mind, I thought for our radiance activity tonight, we can talk a little bit about sunsets, sunsetting, and think about one, respond to this prompt in one of two ways. I want you to think about a time in your life that you experienced radiance as a result of sunsetting something. Or write about something in your life that needs to experience a sunset. And how will that contribute to your radiance? And keep in mind that it is a strategic and intentional action. And it is something that benefits you, that sunset. And I'll give a quick example. I'm a retired early childhood person. I had taught in the classroom for 8 years before taking on a leadership role for 23. And at the end of my career, I had no idea just how burned out I had become. And it was time for me. I was still effective. I was doing a good job. We had great programming, but it was time. it was time for me to be self-reflective and realize that it was taking more and more of me to do what had been so much easier in earlier years. And so I felt like things had run their course, and I didn't want to leave on a low note. I wanted to leave on a high note. And so that sunsetting for me was the decision of leaving a career that I loved, but that time had run its course. And there were some other things in place that sort of pushed me into that, but there was a lot of strategy and intention in that. So that's my example. So I want you to reflect on sunsetting and how that is linked to radiance in your life. And I'll play a song and then come back and check on you.
Thank you.
Everybody, thank you for sharing. Some of you were comfortable with sharing in the chat, and I really appreciate that. There are some very raw and tender things that you shared, and I just want to say I get it. You know, we all have those things that we need to sunset, and, you know, I know that a lot of times we'll look at, you know, what I want to start, what I want to stop, what do I want to continue, and I think when we check in and look at a sunset, it does remind us that the things that we want to stop don't just happen, that there, it is like a sunset. It takes time. It takes time to put those things to bed. And it's important to check in with ourselves every now and then and see what do I have that's going on that I need to have sunset? It's really a beautiful concept because it helps us realize that we can take ownership for putting those things away. So I hope that this was a meaningful experience for you as you consider radiance in light of a sunset. So let's go ahead and start digging into our labyrinth, shall we? I have pulled some images of very, very, very old labyrinths. They have been around for over 4,000 years, which the time continuum always kind of blows my mind. But I just love that they have evidence of these tools that have been used by people before us for literally thousands of years. So this one here on the left, that is from part of Iberia, and they think it dates back to around the Atlantic Bronze Age, which is 1300 to 700 BC, which is crazy to me. This one was actually, it's like a clay tablet. And this one has the earliest secured date. So they know how old this one is, 1200 BC, crazy. And then this one over here on the right is actually a coin, and it has the seven course classical design that represents the labyrinth, which is the one that we're going to actually be doing tonight. So we're doing like a finger or tabletop labyrinth, a small one that can be used, and you use your finger instead of being, you know, physically in a labyrinth to walk. So I have some fun examples to show you of how people have taken the labyrinth to another step. We have some on paper up here, but you can see some folks have done a couple of different designs on pillows. The one on top is embroidery, like with a variegated yarn. The one on bottom has like beading ideas, so that you've created a this person created a trail, yarn on paper, as you see on the bottom left. So there's a lot of, Jessica says, I'm dizzy. So there's a lot of ways to take this to the next step. And you may end up taking the labyrinth you make tonight and adding some texture to it. Someone actually took some like puff paint, glue, and outlined the labyrinth that they made to give it a little more dimension. I love this quote. The point of a maze is to find its center, and the point of a labyrinth is to find your center. So a labyrinth is not a maze. It, you know, somebody said, oh, my favorite movie of my teenage years is now, you know, has led me astray. But it is not a maze, because a maze has blind ends and corners, and it's made to trick you up. Remember the maze, if you have been a subscriber for a couple of months, we had a maze that was in our former journal. And it was kind of, you know, it made a lot of us crazy trying to do it. So a maze, you work your way to the center and then through the other side. A labyrinth is different, because you work your way to the center and you work your way back out. And there is only one meandering path. It's not meant to confuse you. So that's kind of the difference between them. And I think it's important to remember. So we are going to be creating this seven circuit labyrinth. And it's the reason it's a seven circuit labyrinth is that there are seven paths that will lead us eventually to the center. All righty. So a traditional seven circuit classical labyrinth. And we're doing it in a square form because we have grids in our journal. Hallelujah. So this is my labyrinth that I did in preparation for this. And I'm going to lead you through. I've got the exact spot to start you so that we don't go off the page, so that everything lines up and sits well. Wanted to share very quickly that the most important thing to keep in mind in tonight is, or this evening, is to go ahead and open to a notes page. And then I'm going to encourage you to make sure that you put your journal this way so that your spiral is along the top. That's going to be very important. Okay. So that we can go ahead and create our journal. So what this is going to look like is I'm just going to walk you through step by step to make sure that we have our placement in, you know, we have the points and the starting lines and everything in the right place so that we don't end up shifted off the page. And then we'll finish that up and I'm going to give you time to work on it and kind of make it your own and make it beautiful. All righty. So the first thing we're going to do is we're going to count over 20 squares from the left side. So if you'll just literally count over 20, don't write that, right? I don't want you, don't write that. Just count. And then you're going to end up with this line here. And we want you to count up 9 little intersections. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. And just put a dot in that spot. Just a dot. That's it. Okay. And you don't need to draw those little arrows. This is just my tutorial for you guys. And you will see my labyrinth that I did for this is drawn in different colors because each step I did in a different color just to hopefully make that a little bit easier to follow. All right. So I hope everybody has their spot. Now, where this spot is, we're going to make a cross or a T shape. All righty. And you can see you need to make it 4 spaces wide from the middle point. So go up 4 and go 4 spaces over to each side. Literally draw your line. And you should have a T space now or a cross in the middle there, or not the middle of your page, but you know, intersecting with that first dot that you did. All righty. So I'm going to make sure, I think we should all have that. That one's pretty easy. And now you're going to do some little L shapes. So what you do is just count 2 boxes over. All right. 2 from those lines. And you're just going to do L's in each of those corners that you see, each of those corners. And what we're doing is we are actually creating what's called the seed pattern. So we're planting the seeds of the labyrinth, and then the rest of the labyrinth grows from these seeds that we're planting. All righty. So everybody has those, I'm hoping. Let's move on to the next one. Now, where you put those L's, go up and pretend if you were to draw a square, you're going to use that 2 grid spacing again, but just put little dots in each of those corners. And so visually, you can kind of see this box shape, right? All righty. And from this seed pattern grows, I said pattern, like my preschoolers used to say, from this seed pattern grows our labyrinth. All righty. So you're going to see there is a pattern to how we draw the lines. It goes back and forth and back and forth. And that's what's going to create the meandering. All righty. So our first step, we're going to go up to the top, right? Right here. You're going to go up two squares, over two squares, and down two squares to connect to those little L's. And again, I'm encouraging you to be doing this in pencil. Mine are colored so that we can see each step of the way. And if you're doing it in pencil, you can erase. Jessica, too late. It's no worries, because when we're finished, you can go back in and thicken those lines up. And y'all are so funny. Okay, well, you can pick up your pencils now, or be brave, be very brave, and do it in colored pencils. Okay, so there we go. We've got that first part of our labyrinth drawn. The next step. So we did that, right? I want you to slide over to that point. Ready? And it's, again, that two grid spacing. We're so lucky to have these grid sheets. And so you're going to go up and over, and see, we're leaving two spaces, and then down and connect. Okay. So go over to that point, then that corner, go up. And that we're always going to have those two grids spaces. And some folks at the first one of these workshops actually kind of, you know, marked it with their finger, like they did a little dot and a little dot. And then they went back and did the lines. So you may find that's a little bit easier for you. Y'all should have seen me trying to do this. I was telling Bailey, I had a pile of eraser on my... on my desk that was just crazy, because I was, you know, trying to get it all figured out. Okay, so we started here and we went this direction, then we slid over, we went that direction. So we're going to be going back and forth. Oh, Christy, I love that, cross-stitching your labyrinth. I'm going to do a pillow, because I think it'd be great to have that like on my couch, and, you know, it's just there. I haven't done one yet, but I'm going to. All right. So our next step, you guessed it, we're going to slide over in the other direction to this point, using those two grids, and go up, over, leaving two grid spaces there, down, and connect. So see, we're going back and forth from each side as we are drawing this. All righty. So hopefully that is making sense. We were back here. We started here. We went over here. Now we're sliding over and coming around. All righty. So we slid over to this point and we're coming around like that. Okay. I hope maybe you're seeing the pattern of what we do next. Are you ready? We're going to drop down to the point on the cross there. Just go straight down. And we're going to, oh no, you're lost, Marcia. Come back to us. And we're going to follow this orangey colored line. And again, leaving the distance of two spaces in between the previous. Okay, let's go back down. Let's see. We're going to go back over here. So we came and we did this purple line. So we started here. We boom, boom, boom. We come up, we slide over, go the other direction, slide over, go the other direction, come down and go around that way. All right. So that's what we're working on. We're coming to this cross point. We're coming over. And again, some people like to just sort of put those dots in place and then draw their lines. Okay. Yep. Yep. Oh, very good. Amanda says, tip to draw straighter lines is to put a dot where you want to end and look at the dot as you're moving your pen forward. Don't look at what your pen is doing. Focus on, it's kind of like, I guess, when you're doing baseball too, right? You're supposed to look where you're going to throw it. Don't look at the ball and throw it. And don't worry if these mine are not real straight. And I went back and kind of thickened them up with black and it kind of looked stained glassy. So, all righty. So we're ready for the next step. Okay. So we finished up here. We're dropping down to the other cross line in our T. Just drop straight down to that dot. And you guessed it. I just thought, tip to draw straighter line. Don't drink wine during a Sonder social. At least not this kind of Sonder social, right? I may have to go get a glass of wine after this. I always, the labyrinth is supposed to be a great meditation tool that we all need at the end of the labyrinth social, because this is stressing us out. Yes, I will back up, Sam. Hold on a second. So, okay, Sam asked, let's see, let's go backwards. Okay, so we were over here at this cross point. We came around with the orange line and connected. Now we're dropping down and going in the other direction. Like this. Leaving two grid spaces between. That helps us keep it all even. And we're going to connect to this little point here. Oh, y'all are so funny. And yes, you will be able to watch the recording again and again and again. And I'm doing this on Saturday. So join me again. We'll just have like the labyrinth club of Silk and Sonder, right? Okay. So we, here we are. We've drawn, we're almost finished, you guys. Amber says it's a practice round. Don't be hard on yourselves. Don't be hard on yourselves. Okay, so if you remember, we were over here and we came around like this. So now we're going to drop down. And I'll see you then, Jessica. She says, I'll see you on Saturday. We're going to come around this way. Okay, so drop down. Let me get the next slide. We finished up right here. We're going to drop down. And again, using the two grids for our spacing, and we're going to draw this brownish color line, or it's brown on mine, but this is the line that we're drawing, and we connect with that L shape right there. It makes your brain go, rrr. Like I said, you guys, I know it's a little tricky. There was no way I could put a camera on this and do it live. No way. We would have all been a mess. So that's why it's pre-done, because, oh my goodness, so funny. Oh, good. Karen says it's her second time and she's doing better. So, alrighty. So we went to that bottom dot and we've just come around. And this is actually this back and forth motion from side to side is what's creating our meandering path. All righty. Okay. So hopefully you know what we're doing next, right? Here's where we are. We ended up right there at that bottom L intersection. We're dropping down and then we're going to take this one around. So let's show you what that looks like. We're dropping down. And we're taking this one around. We are almost finished. We're using those two grids as our spacer. Come back up and connect. All right, use wide out. And remember, this is in pencil, hopefully. And then we'll revisit it with, and you can just really go heavy with your markers or your colored pencils. And it kind of hides all our little mistakes. Anyway, we're breaking up with perfection every single day in Silk and Sonder. All righty. So I'm hoping you've got that one. And we finished up here. And my Sonder souls, we are going to the bottom of the T or the cross. And we are going down and around and finishing this puppy up all the way around and connecting with that bottom L over on the left. And Amber, you said a washi tape labyrinth would be fun. I have a picture to show you that someone did from our first one. So I'll throw that on here for you. So really it's a back and forth motion with this labyrinth. Oh, Sam, you're completely lost. I'm sorry. Okay. I don't know what to tell you guys. But hopefully it's looking a little something like that, right? Okay, I'll see you on Saturday. Someone's out. Or you might want to stay and finish this so you know what to expect. All righty. So this is kind of, oh, yay, five-year-olds can be very big critics, Caitlin. So I'm glad they like it. So this is kind of what it should sort of look like. And you can, if you look close enough, there's a lot of erasures that Jennifer Ogilvie did. So then what I did is I put on some music and took out my corners and kind of curved it to give it a little more flow and grace, right? If you get stuck in the labyrinth, you might, yeah, but we'll figure it out. We will figure it out. Yeah, just keep that two corner spacing or the two grids. I can't imagine doing this freehand in a round shape. All righty. Okay. Sam said her doctor called. Sam, there will be a recording of this. Let's see, you were on the orange part. So that's way over here. And really, if you can just kind of keep in mind, we're going back and forth. So you'll do the orange, drop down, come back around. It's kind of boom. You just keep dropping down and going in the opposite direction. All righty. Okay. And I want to make sure I'm paying attention to our time. So I'm going to show you, this is what my end result. You can see I went back. I put a lot of black and heavy in there. I'm going to leave you with some music and some quotes. Some people like to write this in the path of their labyrinth. Some they might want, you might want to use words. So I'll show you these. And then these are some of the labyrinth from the first time we met on this social. Here's the washi tape one that someone went back over with washi tape on theirs. And you can see they're all very different. So I'm going to throw on some music while you start to take time. So yes, pull out the sparkle gel. But you create, make it beautiful. And you'll see the words release, receive, return. That is going to be part of our meditation practice that I will share with you once we have a little time to kind of make these our own. All righty. So let's listen to some music and I'll come back and check on you. And then we will kind of walk through. You probably won't finish up, so you can do this later, but I do want to make sure we leave time so I can walk you through what a meditation practice with your labyrinth looks like. Okay, guys. So I know that you need some more time to really make this yours. And I love, I saw somebody say my May journal is in my mailbox and I'm going to put an even better one in that one. So yes, I love it. And Bailey already shared the link, but the YouTube, I know that the Labyrinth Social from the first time I did this is up. And so you could even go and use that as a resource. Yeah, she just dropped it in there. So if you want to go and rewatch so you can finish this up tonight, or again, you can join me on Saturday. I'd love to see you again. So let's really quickly, because we are going to, I don't want to run out of time and not have an opportunity to show you how to use this beautiful thing that you're creating this evening. So when you do the labyrinth, there are three main parts to the practice of the mindfulness meditation. So the first one is release. And to prepare to use a labyrinth, you know, you want to just sit quietly and take a couple of really deep, meaningful cleansing breaths, quiet your space around you, or maybe put on some very beautiful soft music, light a candle, the things that you would do when you are trying to escape for a little while, to take time for yourself, for some good breathing and all that good stuff. You may have something on your mind. You may go to your labyrinth with something that's been, you know, floating around in your brain that you're trying to have some resolution. Maybe you'll revisit the thing that you wrote about for sunsetting and use that as your mindfulness activity. And so what you'll do is you will start and you'll put your non-dominant hand finger, pointer finger. So I'm right-handed. So I would use my left pointer finger to enter the labyrinth. And you enter down here. You enter down here on the left. And one of our Sonder family, Reverend Joy Ellen, mentioned she is like a licensed facilitator for doing labyrinth walks with her church. And she said, you will notice that the entrance is on the left. And that reminds us of the fact that our heart is on the left of our body, which I love. So you'll take your non-dominant finger and enter on the left, and then you begin to meander. And the reason we use non-dominant is that it helps us, again, be more mindful of the actual practice of walking the labyrinth. There's not any muscle memory happening with your dominant hand. And so you will slowly move toward the middle. As you can see, I used my middle as a radiant. I kind of went with the sunshine colors. And you just breathe and move that finger through slowly and contemplate and just slowly meander through your labyrinth. As you get to the center, your mind should be quieting and you can linger once you hit the center and just hold space there. And again, breathe, pay attention to your body, the muscles, just kind of listen to what's going on in your head and your heart and just rest there. I love that. Just rest there. That is your receiving time. So we release, we work our way to the center to receive. And after you've hung out there a little while and you're ready, you will return and you walk back out. You walk back out. You trace your non-dominant finger back out again. All right. You'll hopefully maybe just be in a calmer headspace, or you may end up with a revelation. One day it may be like, okay, that was just a nice break to my day, and there's not any big whoa moments. And other days, something may be laid upon your heart and you find yourself that you've solved something or come up with an answer to a question that's been sort of bouncing around. So every labyrinth experience is going to be different for each one of us, but each one of our experiences will be different depending on where we are at any moment in time that we do sit with our labyrinth. So what I want to do is I'm going to hold this slide on release, receive, return. And I want you to do a practice and take that non-dominant pointer finger and enter at the left. I'm going to play a song or two and just kind of meander through that. Be sure you're breathing. Be sure that you're relaxing your shoulders, relaxing your whole body. And let's just kind of see what happens. Okay, so that was an abbreviated time. I love seeing that some of you are already seeing how this can be used as a calming tool, a mechanism to take that time for yourself. There are a million labyrinths ready to be printed out, a finger labyrinth, tabletop labyrinth for you to print out, and you can color and make your own. However, I will say that I think investing the time in creating your own really adds a lot to the overall experience because it truly is yours. You may be putting scripture on it. You may be getting those mantras that you've carried in your heart your whole life. So anyhow, I'm so glad that you guys took time to work on your own labyrinth today. And I, again, will point you to the YouTube if you want to do that. And then I'll be joining you again on Saturday if you want to come and do a little fine tuning, or you can sit and fine tune yourself. Yeah, it is a little tricky. Once you get the hang of it, it's like, ah, and you know what? It's important for our brains to do hard things, right? That challenge that keeps our brains nice and crisp. So if it were too easy, it wouldn't be worth it, right? We did our brains a big old favor by helping us really think today. So I stressed you out, and then I hopefully helped you find some peace by walking your labyrinth. So if you've been to one of these before, you know that we would love to see you on Sonder Club if you're comfortable posting your labyrinth. And you can join Sonder Club by either clicking on one of, using your QR reader, or Bailey will drop the links in, or you can just kind of look it up in your app stuff on your phone. You'll be receiving a survey about this labyrinth. Social, about all the socials. And it's important for you, if you ever have ideas about your Silk and Sonder experience, to include those in any surveys that you take from our socials, because that's how we keep growing and trying to meet what our users want. Like, I know as facilitators, we'll be like, have you ever thought about doing this? And so we want to know your feedback. That's so important. Be sure to check us out on Instagram. There's great content there. And then see you in Sonder Club. And then there's my playlist. There's some extra bonus ones on there because I tend to talk too much and we didn't get them all played, but I sure did enjoy spending my time with you. Bailey and I are so glad that you now have your own labyrinth. And you guys just have an amazing week as you kind of, we're sort of now going into the downslide of April. We're going to walk on out of here with a little Katrina in the waves because we've been on our journeys tonight. Love you, Sonder fam. Good night.